Thank you very much for coming to this panel. And it's great to see you all here on a beautiful sunny day in Cannes. Thank you also to Reed Meadham and MIPDoc for allowing us to present what the buyers want session, and for the technical team at the back for showing us all the promos. We've got a great lineup of commissioning editors and distributors on this panel today who reach far across the world in terms of the channels that they're buying for. And I'm hoping that after we finish, we'll get a real insight into what they're looking for and what they're buying for 2015, 2016. Also, I want to quickly mention that afterwards, you can meet all of the panel. We have another session, which will be 30 minutes in the Buyers and Commissioners Club. So if you want to chat directly to any of them, that's going to be your opportunity. And I'm sure they'll be very interested in hearing what you've got to present. If you get the opportunity to meet with them. So my name is Edwina Thring. My company is Wild Thring Media. We co-finance programs for the international market. I've been in touch with the commission editors on this panel for many years. But what I'd like them to do is we'll go down the panel. Each individual will introduce themselves, their network, and tell you what their current responsibilities are. We'll then come back and we'll look at a promo for each network and then discuss the kind of programming that the commissioning editors are looking for. So, Corentin.
Yep. My name is Corentin Glutron. Hi, everyone. I'm the head of the acquisition of the channel RMC Découverte in France.
And your current responsibilities?
The head of the acquisition. Great. I'm buying programs.
Very quiet voice. So my name's Angela Neillis, and I work at FremantleMedia's international arm, which is FMI. I am the director of all non-scripted programming, which ranges from entertainment through to documentary and everything in between. And we have an investment fund which we spend on acquiring rights in new content, and then we sell it around the world. And I specifically look after non-North American content, so primarily looking to talk to producers from UK, Australia, and Europe.
Hi, I'm Nesta Owens. I head up programming for Discovery Networks CEMEA, which is Central Eastern Europe, Middle East, and Africa. So anywhere is kind of, it's a bit strange. We've just taken over responsibilities for Germany. So anything east of Germany, down through the Middle East, down into Africa, is all falls under my remit. I have to find about 10,000 hours of content a year across 16 channel brands and 109 countries. That's a mixture of commissioning, pre-buying, and I also maintain our output deal with our cousins in the US. So we're incredibly busy, but I'm excited to tell you all about it in a second.
Hi, my name is Hengyi. I'm the manager of Da Neng Culture Media. I'm in charge of acquisition and co-production. We acquire 200 hours per year. We welcome documentary from across the world.
Thank you. So that's our panel. We're going to come back to Corentin and RMC Découverte and show his promo that he's put together.
Doubt till the love runs out.
Thank you, Corentin. Now, that is a great promo. I can feel a lot of adrenaline coming out of that.
I think I don't have to say anything after that. You know exactly what I'm looking for, definitely. So thank you. Bye.
No. So I would say there's a bit of male skew, younger
definitely.
Demographic going on
yeah,
there.
Definitely it's a male skewing audience. More young, of course, 15 to 49 years old, and a high profile. That's the basic audience we have. And actually, we're buying around 1,200 hours a year. Of course, at the beginning, it was a lot of acquisition only because the channel is quite new. It was launched in December 2012, so we are not 3 years old now. So it was basically only acquisition at the beginning, and now we're starting to producing a lot of content. As a matter of fact, I'm buying around 1,200 hours, and now the amount of hours produced are around 200 hours. So that's a lot.
Wow, that's a lot.
And we are working with around 50 different producers, of course from France, mostly because we have the quotas thing. We have to invest in French production. And we are working a little bit with also European producers.
Okay, well, can we just define the kind of slots that you're buying for and the genres of documentary, because that was filled.
Yeah, you've seen a lot of genres. We have five major topics, which are, of course, history, the 20th century, science. You've seen the universe, for example. We do have real life, which is a slot for character-driven series, which you know all of them, the kind of series we're looking for. We have an adventure slot, which is for Man vs. Wild, for example. And at last, we have like travel slot, but travel with adventure slot. And that's basically it. We also have, of course, the Top Gear slot, which is, since the beginning of the channel, Wednesday evening all the time. So this is what we're looking for. And very easy, I guess.
Good, so that's a clear definition. And in character-driven series, it's fine for them being speaking on camera. I mean, in certain European territories, that's a problem, but this seems to work for your...
Yeah, it does good, actually. But the thing is that for character-driven series, it's good to have also our own hosts, because it's always getting better when we have French version of the same program. Of course, when the host is French, it does very, very good ratings. For example, we were broadcasting Top Gear, the UK version and the US version since the beginning of the channel, and we just launched the French version a month ago, and the ratings were just massive. For example, the best ratings we have with the UK version was around 500,000 viewers, and the first episode of Top Gear reached 1 million viewers. So that's, we doubled the ratings, which is massive for us. Mm-hmm. So this is something very relevant for us to have the French version and the French hosts and the French program. This is something very important.
So this is a localized programming is a trend for you?
Definitely a huge trend. That's why we are trying to work with a lot of producers, French producers, of course, to get more and more involved in French production with French hosts and French content.
So members of the audience here can sell completed programming to you.
Yep.
If they wanted to co-produce a program for RMC, Découverte, would they have to work with a French production company?
It is always good to work with a French producer because of the investment we have to do with French companies, but you can work with them as a foreign company, and of course, if you're a European company, it could work also. We are working a lot with the UK, of course, because they know how to, this content is specialized for them, they know already how to do it. So we have a lot to learn from them also. But you can work, if you are from anywhere around the world, if you are able to work with a French company, you can work with us too.
Okay, that sounds great. And in terms of going back to the completed programming series and long-running series from your program, what you're saying are obviously top of your list. Is there room for one-offs on the channel?
Yeah, of course. There's room for one-offs. Basically, of course, we are looking for series because it's easier for us to broadcast series. But if you have a one-off, very, very strong, very relevant for us, if it's relative with, let's say, an anniversary or special event we can broadcast, that's not a problem for us. Even if it's a feature-length program, we can do it also. Everything is doable for us. You just have to fit the good moment or the good slot. Everything you can ask me for everything, I can buy this.
Good. It sounds like
not everything. Don't listen to me.
Right. Line up. He's going to buy everything.
Send me the thing.
And if someone wants to pitch a program to you, how do they do that?
For co-production or acquisition?
Well, for acquisitions.
Acquisition, you just send me an email with the program, and I'm screening everything. So that's easy. And basically, you have to wait, let's say, 2 weeks, and we try to answer to everyone. That's the policy of the house.
Okay, so that's a really good response time, 2 weeks. Do you have a team working with you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
A lot of people, we are thousands of us. No, we're two of us. But we are screening a lot because we like it.
Okay. And in terms of co-productions, how would that work?
In terms of co-production, you send us just a project. It can be short. It doesn't have to take like 20, 50 pages. It can be like 4 or 5. And you have to, of course, a financial plan, a budget. If you have some footage already, it could be good. It has to be relevant for the channel, of course, for the slots. And if you have a host, it has to be an interview of the host, of course, because that's what makes the difference for the channel.
Okay.
Definitely. And the delay of answer is, let's say, 45 days, which is, I guess, pretty fast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, that's amazing. I don't know how the broadcasters turning around programming within 2 weeks and 45 days for co-production. I'm going to come and pitch. thank you very much, Corentin. That's a really great overview of what your channel is doing. And if we could move on. Thank you to Angela. Angela works for Fremantle and has a promo to show, and then we'll go on to discuss what she's looking for. So thank you. That's another great promo and shows a real breadth of programming.
Yeah, I mean, sorry, it was a little bit on the long side, but what I did want to show is the huge range of types of show that we take on. I snuck in Planet's Got Talent, which is probably slightly off topic for MIPDoc, but actually that kind of clip show has done really well for us, and that's already selling around the world, even though we're just launching it now. we also had a show quite recently with Mr. T, and people just come back and back and ask if we're making anything more like that. So that's why I wanted to show that one. And then two of the shows in the reel, Dogs, Their Secret Lives, and An Hour to Save Your Life, we're launching both of those as format and tape, so we've got very different ways of investing in and then selling shows. And then the 60s at the end, the 70s, sorry, which followed on from the 60s last year, that's what I really love about that, and it's actually an acquisition by my colleague Haley Dixon in the US, is that it's a return to proper documentary making commissioned by CNN, and good volume, and just really good interviews, a huge depth of history covered, but in a really entertaining way, and then hosted by Tom Hanks. So, you know, that obviously shouted out for us, and lots of people interested in that.
So, fundamentally, you're picking up the programs for your international catalogue,
yeah.
Which you're then taking out worldwide to sell.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, we're obviously known as a very big production company as well, but aside from that, FMI has a business, a standalone business, which invests and co-produces with partners all around the world to help fund shows, get shows on the air, and then obviously, you know, a big remit to bring back a commercial return. So, you know, commercial is good for us. But it doesn't, you know, within that, we've got, you know, some very, you know, excellent producer relationships and great programs of all varieties.
So we're here at MIPDoc, and are you down here on looking for a particular genre of programming to boost your catalogue?
Yeah, I mean, what I have particularly liked recently is that we've kind of a slight steer back from reality program making, which isn't so easy for us to sell, and towards kind of science shows. You know, nature always sells very well for us, and we've got a couple of shows with Nigel Marvin and Boundless, one of Fremantle's producers. So we're looking for shows which have a global reach and an international vibe about them. Entertaining is obviously top of the list, but yes, and you know, we can. I'm meeting with lots of producers. Shows are generally commissioned, in some sense of the word, financed. We complete finance rather than will fund. But you know, that financing can be from 10% to, you know, up to 30-50%. Depends on the show and depends on, you know, what we're doing with the show.
Okay, up to 50% of a budget. That's it. That's very,
yeah,
positive.
I mean, we have a lot of you know, good producer relationships. If we know we can take it out to the market and it's got a long shelf life, then you know that's of interest to us. I would say 10-25% is typical. investments.
And do you see a specific trend that's happening at the moment? I mean, you mentioned this 60 series has done very well for you.
Yeah. Science has actually seems to pop up quite a lot recently. I was at Real Screen earlier this year, and it's really edifying to see that science can be done in a really interesting way that, you know, that people are, you know, audiences want to watch. It's not dry, it's not kind of, you know, there's no lecturing going on. Something like An Hour to Save Your Life, which is a boundless, a Fremantle company, that's a show which is absolutely packed with science. It's it was done as a co-production with the Open University, and the whole thrust of the documentary was to talk about medical technology and innovations, roadside operations, literally. But at its core, it's human stories, and each story is carried by each episode is carried by three stories of human beings who, you know, are transported by these doctors, by this innovation, you know, to survive within that hour. So that for me is a fascinating way of showing science whilst being terrifically entertaining as well.
Yeah, no, it's a great title as well. Now to say
it is. I mean, they talk about the golden hour where, you know, these emergency response units get to you know, a person who's suffering a trauma and manage to turn around life within that hour, and it is it's very you know, moving as well. It's kind of, you know, these are people's lives.
And approximately how many hours do you look to pick up for your catalogue per year?
I knew I had some homework to do.
Well, your catalogue is 20,000 hours, so it's big.
We do. You know, we don't have a set number of hours. We've probably brought, I'm looking over at, I think I've got 25 new shows at this market in the non-scripted area.
Okay, so.
And within that, I've got hours, I've got a couple of, like, one-offs, but mostly series of kind of 6 to 10 hours. So.
Okay, well, that's...
If you can do your math.
That sounds like a lot.
Yeah.
And if members of the audience want to pitch and send proposals to you, do you have a team working with you?
I do, a small team. So we're spread between London and LA. There are two of us in non-scripted in London, and there are three in LA. An email, an email conversation, treatment, and then, you know, how the shows come about, funding, commissioners, you know, who's involved. I think that kind of kicks off a conversation, and then, you know, we're actually very kind of quick turnaround. You know, shows are often come to us quite well funded already, so, you know, the show's in production generally, so, you know, within a year it'll go to market.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, well, that sounds great. Thank you for that overview. Moving on, Nesta is from Discovery EMEA, and we're going to play a promo.
The growth engine of the world's number one pay TV programmer is Discovery Networks International. And Discovery Networks Semia, formed in January 2011, is part of that driving force.
It's on, baby!
Across three continents, spanning 109 countries.
Amazing.
Broadcasting in 20 languages and captivating more than 500 million subscribers. We're bigger and stronger than ever.
Electrifying.
Built on a belief in great television programs that spark the imagination, feed minds, and satisfy curiosity.
Seeing people's faces light up.
Discovery Network Semia is a phenomenal success story.
Come on!
Experience the thrill.
This is Discovery Channel.
How you like me now?
Wow.
How you like me now? How you like me now? How you like me now? Remember the time.
Oh, yes!
Yeah!
It's beautiful, but it can kill you.
Yes, yes, yes!
Yeah!
Oh, it's the thrill of finding out stuff.
The number one factual channel in Russia.
Hello, Russia.
Hey, Moscow.
And the number one factual channel in Poland.
Dzień dobry.
Dzień dobry, Poland.
Discovery Channel is a multiple award winner.
Wow!
And the success is spreading.
I don't know where to start.
Mamma mia!
Our female viewers have helped put the name of our flagship lifestyle channel on everyone's lips.
nothing to do.
Are you saying yes to the dress?
TLC leads the way in bringing international quality television.
How cool is that?
That's very cool.
Closer to its local audiences.
You're so sweet, Nat.
With original local commissions. Local talent ambassadors.
Ты что, не видишь, я работаю?
And unique local voices.
We love TLC!
As well as showing global exclusives. But look closer. The true story is never as straightforward as you think.
ID Extra.
With our newest flagship channel.
Beautiful, dirty, dirty, rich. Dirty, dirty, beautiful, dirty, rich.
With real-life stories full of powerful emotions, high-stakes drama, and shocking scandals. ID Extra is already the number one mystery and suspense channel across Europe.
What beautiful and dirty rich.
Surprise!
Dirty rich.
With 46 million subscribers across EMEA, Animal Planet is still one of our best-loved channels.
That's a monster!
And this is just the beginning of our journey. With a diverse and expanding portfolio of channels, Discovery Network EMEA has a tailored strategy for growth. And we're proud that Eurosport, the number one pan-European sports channel, has joined the Discovery team.
That's what I'm talking about.
We're leading the way in new technologies, harnessing the power of Discovery with inspirational ideas.
Anything is possible.
This is Discovery Network EMEA.
I'm exhausted just watching that.
Yeah, another great promo pack full of programming. Yep. Now, Nesta, do you ever leave the office?
Not really, no.
I understand that you were buying for 15 channel brands.
16.
It's overnight. Gone up.
It's overnight. Gone up. Overnight.
Can't keep
16,
up.
16, yeah. We launched something clearly.
In 20 languages, you're versioning into in 109 countries.
Yeah. So that's an awful lot of hours.
That is, and when you said 10,000 hours, I was like, my God.
I know. I mean, obviously, we do get an awful lot of content from the US. We have Phil, Craig's team, India and I, they supply us with lots and lots of content. So our role in London, looking after all these regions, is basically plugging the gaps and trying to localise our channels as much as possible, bringing in sort of locally relevant shows. Just an example of what we're buying at the moment, something like Walking the Nile that we've picked up from Sky Vision with Levinson Wood in it. So he's great, great talent, great experiential show, based in Africa, so great for big tick for Africa. We've had a lot of success with things like Ed Stafford, so having a similar show. I mean, Ed Stafford, it takes him a year to make 6 hours. So in between times, we need more of that kind of stuff. So having something like Walking the Nile is great for us. We've bought an awful lot of trash to cash stuff over the last couple of years for Discovery across all of Central Eastern Europe. So Storage Wars, Storage Hunters, all of that kind of stuff. We've bought an awful lot of hours of that. So there's all of that stuff going on. We've bought Troy, we've bought Dynamo. So we're just plugging the gaps with kind of fun, entertaining shows and trying to bring a bit of local relevance to all our Discovery feeds across all of EMEA.
So can we just drill down a bit? I mean, obviously, we're not going to be able to go through the 15 channels.
No.
But there are four top channels that...
So Discovery is clearly our flagship. It's the most widely distributed channel that we have. It is in 109 countries. All the other channel brands will be in varying numbers of those countries. As I say, so a huge amount of content for Discovery from the US. We are, I'm here to tell you today that we are branching out into commissioning far more. We're not just going to curate channels now. We are moving very much more into commissioning and co-producing, especially in Poland, but also in Germany and also in Russia. We had a lot of success last year with a one-off that was filmed in Russia about the most dangerous road in Russia, and it played incredibly well in Poland and incredibly well in Germany. So we're trying to see what the synergies are between those three countries working together, and you know, a show that made in Germany transmitting in Russia and all that kind of stuff, and using Russian talent in Germany and Poland. So that's something that we're really excited about. And I think in Poland alone, we're commissioning 120 hours of male factual content just for Poland. So that's kind of quite exciting, quite big news for us.
So you're moving from a syndicated model to localising and commissioning in the regions.
Absolutely. Next year, we have kind of in the budget 200 hours of male factual content for Poland alone. So that's quite a huge step change for us. So we're really growing the team in Poland. In the first instance, after today, just send things through to me, but I will pump it out to the development team that we have, that we're starting to grow in Poland. So that's really
Any
exciting
Polish
times.
Any Polish producers here? Oh, yep. There you go.
See me afterwards.
German producers.
Yeah, absolutely. And Russians as well. Moving on to our kind of more female networks, we've got TLC. I mean, TLC, we do get a lot of great content for the US, but it's very much more driven by acquisitions. Again, in Poland, we've always commissioned, and in Russia, we've always commissioned. I think last year we did 50 hours in Poland. I think we're about 30 hours this year. We have made shows that have transmitted all over the place. So we did a great show on IVF in Poland that went to Russia. We then did a localized version of a similar show in Russia.
So for TLC, it's female
skew. It's very female. We buy MasterChef. It's quite it's a more factual entertainment than straight lifestyle, although there are much more varieties of TLC within the networks. Discovery is just kind of is one umbrella brand. Everybody kind of gets what it is. TLC, slightly more nuanced. So in the Balkans, it's more of a traditional lifestyle channel. Same is true in Russia. In Poland, however, it's more of a factual entertainment show. We're really big into innovation on Discovery and TLC. We want to be first with new ideas, first with new great content. So we've been the first to have Dating Naked in TLC in Poland. They're slightly prudish in Poland, am I right? So having that much nudity, we had to show the show after 11. We've also had Adam Looking for Eve as well, which is another great kind of social experiment sort of format. So we buy an awful lot for all of our TLCs, and we buy 24 hours in the A&E MasterChef. Loads and loads of really, really great shows. We have an ID Extra, which is our crime channel. Again, we get great content from the US, but we do have pockets of needs across the network. They don't have kind of the Ofcom regulations in the US that we have, so we're always in the market for daytime safe, playable content, which is a slightly oxymoronic, you know, safe murder. But... so we've been focusing more on missing people, white collar crime, that kind of stuff. Stuff that tends to be slightly less bloody than murders. We've also started dipping our toe into fiction on ID, especially in Poland. And we're also commissioning some shows, some crime shows for Poland. Have I mentioned Poland enough yet? For IG. So we're looking to commission 6 hours for this year, and then we've got more in the budget for next year. So watch this space on that one. Happy to brief anybody on that those commissions.
And Animal Planet, just quickly?
Animal Planet is... our organising thought for Animal Planet is animal entertainment. We need animals front and centre. You know, the stuff that we get from the States is slightly not animal-centric enough for us. So we always need animals. We want a special USP. We want people to think of what the promo might look like as they are pitching the show. It needs to be new, different, energised. And more, as you said, Angela, entertaining is one of the key things for us.
And in light of Rich Ross's words, who's the new boss at Discovery, authentic is a word that seems to come up.
Absolutely.
Has that changed the direction of programming?
I think it's great. That's great news for us in CME. I think we've always been kind of the bastions of keeping the brand kind of quite pure, quite not old school, but you know, quite traditional. So it's great for us as a return to our core values. We think it'll really resonate with our viewers. Be interesting to see how. Thank you. It'd be interesting to see how that actually, in a more sort of modern context, how that actually pans out. But we're really excited to see. The first shows will be coming through, I think, at the end of July. So
great.
Watch a space.
Scripted is a word that seems to raise its head.
Yeah, so I mean, we've dipped our toe for Discovery, especially. We've had Klondike, we've had a few Gunslingers, we've had a few sort of shows, but we are really interested in, you know, we watch enviously as History Channel have Vikings, and you know, Nat Geo have Killing Jesus and all those sort of franchises. So we're just interested in seeing what that could look, what a factual. Semi-scripted factual show could look for Discovery Senior. So again, if you have any ideas in that kind of space, that would be really interesting to us also.
So finally, Nesta, pitching. How do we work with your team?
I was going to have a great slide with everybody's names on, but it never quite happened. Apologies for that. So if you just send things through to me in the first instance, and I will bounce it to the appropriate person internally. I'm hoping you're getting the impression that we're really busy, because we are really busy, so we can't quite promise two-week turnarounds, but we'll be as super quick as we can.
Okay. Well, thank you. I think that's another
honest,
great overview.
At least.
And we have Hengyi from Da Neng Culture Media, and who has another great promo to show us. That's another great promo. Now, Hengyi, I feel that promo is slightly different. It's not like the adrenaline pumping of Discovery and RMC Découverte. So does that reflect the type of programming you're seeking?
Well, we're not a network. We're not a TV station. I think I have to start with the nature of the company. We are distributor and commissioning editor. We buy the content from international market, and then we syndicate it to broadcasters across China. That's basically what we do. And the promo you have seen is the content that works for us. In China, the history always works, and cotton fields, wildlife, and the science is the new trend that works for us. But I need to define the history, which is slightly different than the international market. We always see in Europe the history program that worked for the American, Eurocentric, and we're Sinocentric. We need a program that is related to China. For example, last year is a 100-year World War I anniversary. A lot of great program got produced, but we never participated in the Great War. So when you put this kind of program on TV, a lot of Chinese audience, massive audiences, was saying there's nothing to do with us. And this year's World War II, we did. We participated in the war. We fought with the Japan. And we got a seat in the Security Council. That's the stuff we interested in. And Asian history always work. But if you mention Battle of Hastings, nobody knows about it. but you have to say the Great War, and the journey of Chinese Navy, then that works for us. That's the problem I always encounter in MIP. You got great history stuff, and you come to us, and then the massive audience have nothing really familiar with. That's the thing. For nature stuff, nature works great. 20 years ago, we had the slot in a CCTV called Animal World. Kids love it, and adult love it, and this is stuff that works everywhere.
And is that maybe blue chip wildlife, or do you, can you have presenters in the wildlife as well?
You know, we have 260 channels.
Okay.
And the various. sometimes you have complete program, you have TV host, presenters. But it's a great question. TV program we license from international market. We don't show that. A lot of TV stations, they don't show that in a complete way. We reshape the program, we re-edit the program. So if you're a producer, you want a big program to be complete with logo on, it's not possible. It's impossible. And science is great. I mean, we licensed 20 hours last year just from French TV station, the distributors. It works really well. Though we are not network, we get feedback from TV stations. They love the stuff, and they're really shining, lavish detailed graphics. Audience just love kind of stuff. And Cannes Fairs, it's always tricky. It's always tricky. Mm-hmm. Because the nature, we're in Cannes, we're not in New York City, we're not in United Nations, we're not discussing any politics. But you know, the nature of broadcasting system is not really into the Cannes Fairs. But the changes varies. Last year we licensed Afghanistan, the war on terror, which is really shocking for me. I wouldn't expect such program to be licensed, put on broadcasting. It did, it worked. And Osama bin Laden and Iraq, war in Iraq, it worked really well. So this kind of evaluation system, let's maybe say evaluation system, works. It works, it changes every single time. But I needed to say this as a conclusion. Chinese market is emerging. It's an emerging market, which means, I see some of my clients here, the license fee we pay is not much to the international standard yet. But 3 years ago, 1 hour program only was $60. $60. Wow. Now we can pay averagely $4,000 or $6,000. So imagine that, it's doubles.
Wow.
It's doubles, triples,
I'm looking I'd imagine for the next 4 years.
Yeah, exactly. It's like our economy. Economy 20 years ago. So that's the market. I mean, if you're working, if you're going to want to get quick rich and you've got a lot of benefits in the Chinese market, that's not for you. But if you're long run, that's definitely work.
And how many hours, I mean, those are multiple channels that you're selling programming to, how many hours per year are you looking to acquire for your company?
We, in average, would get 200 hours a year. And this year, just for history, we get 150 hours.
Okay, so history is the major.
Yeah, this year is a major because 70th anniversary.
And you've just moved into your first co-production and looking to do more.
Yeah, most definitely. We did a co-production with an Italian company. It worked pretty well. So we're definitely looking for more opportunity of co-production. Our market is opening, and we're looking for a talent co-producer coming over, and we do great topics putting international market. We do have a team. We do have a team to evaluate the topic. The co-production project need to have at least 40% of the finance. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Then we can work on, we can provide assistance, we can get permission if you shooting in China. But the thing is, it's not only us, every broadcaster in China, every production houses and company, you have to have something related to China. I've seen great stuff at the end of the GT Dog, Hot Dog, and you know the festival in China. Mm-hmm. It's not just you putting a Chinese guy in the film and say this is China related.
So the subject matter has to have some kind of China related theme to it. Okay, well that's great. Now you said you've been mainly working with French production companies, but you're here, you want to meet more people, more international distributors, so this is a great opportunity for people to try and work with you.
Yeah.
And if they want to get in touch with you, pitch programming, how is it your team or can they come directly to you?
You can send an email directly to me and we discuss the make a selection over the internally and we get your feedback. I think efficiency is one of our advantage. We can get a screening film a week and we can get the license fee paid in within 2 weeks.
Okay, well, this panel's going really well because people are turning things around very quickly.
We have people to testify.
Well, Hengyi, thank you very much for that. It's great to see what you're looking for the Chinese market. Thank you very much to our panelists. Now, we're running a bit short of time, so I wanted to open up to the audience to see if anyone had any particular questions for any of the broadcasters. No? Oh, one here. Sorry, there's a microphone just coming.
Sorry, for a question for RMC. Do you ever work with Africa, South Africa specifically? Or would you consider?
Yeah, I've been in touch with a couple of producers there, yeah. Not in co-production, of course, but in acquisition, yeah, we can work with every country in the world, of course.
So
yeah.
Acquisition, but not co-production.
Only do a lot of great wildlife, so yes, we do.
Okay, but only in terms of acquisition, not in terms of co-pro or commissioning?
That's pretty much more difficult, except if you find a French producer to work with you. Is going to be.
And then you'd consider?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Thank you. Any more questions? Yep.
Thank you. I was going to ask about digital stuff around the programming and whether producers are coming to you with those sorts of stuff as well, or whether that's something that happens after the buying process. Are you thinking about web and apps and so on?
That's something that we're just getting into now. We're a bit behind the curve, to be honest. In Central Eastern Europe, we've got director of digital now, and we are actively trying to get behind things. I mean, for acquisitions, it's often quite hard to get that digital assets. We're trying to incorporate a 360 approach when we commission much more, but it is still slightly an afterthought. We're trying to bring it further up the thought process, but we are definitely, this is our big boss, JB Perrette, is from a digital background, and it's something that he's really, really wants to get behind. So, yeah, it's something that's growing for us.
Any more questions? Okay, well, thank you very much to the panelists. I think it's been a great session, and we've really sort of got an insight on what you're looking for. Don't forget that you can meet all the panelists in the Buyers and Commissioners Club and ask them any questions you have directly. Thank you very much for coming, and enjoy MIPDoc.